Okay, so its work is a part of a rather broad investigation around some topics of what we call applied topology. You know, topology is as a science was born in the early 20th century as a service discipline to address sort of to prove theories about differential equations without actually studying differential equations. So if you don't want to solve something explicitly, you want to produce some answers. Concurrent topology exactly for this purpose. So topology used to be applied discipline, but then it evolved into this abstract nonsense. Everybody knows about that abstract nonsense. And but still there is light there, and that's this is one of the sort of outcomes of the effort funded by our generous friends at the Department of Defense. And the problem is, like, imagine the James Bond team, like James Bond going down the, James Bond going down the slope, avoiding the bullets and avoiding the trees. And imagine, you want to plan it, right? You're a movie director, or maybe you're, maybe it's a robot, or maybe it's whatever. You want to plan its movement, right? How many ways are going between those trees? Or within those bullets? How many ways do you want to go there? So, switching to math, so what we want to do, he goes down the slope, so there is a direction cone, he cannot climb up. Right? So there is a direction cone which tells you which velocities I allow. Okay? And also there are obstacles which you want to avoid. But this is what you want to do, and even that, you want to try to understand what are the essentially different ways to move down the slope. And by essentially different, I mean, I don't want to distinguish between those two paths, because they go between in the same way between the obstacles. So they have two different paths, both respecting our constraints, that the velocity goes down the cone, and we are not hitting the obstacle. So it's fair to identify, it sort of looks about the same thing to us. So we want to understand how many different ways of hitting obstacle, how many of those is there. So this is the problem, we'll try to address it here. And maybe I'll ask first a question. So, I'll go backwards. So this is the cone, right? So, maybe it's too complicated for you, but this is the type of questions I give it to kids in elementary school in the math circle, just asking how many essential ways. And surprisingly, well, they can do it. Typically the people, PhDs in the audience, I ask, they're typically mistaken by, factor of two, to try to count the number of ways. So essentially, this is talk about an efficient way to count the different ways to go down the slope, and maybe something. Okay, so but there is motivation. There is motivation is actually coming. This problem is not coming from watching James Bond movie or teaching elementary school kids. It's coming. So the motivation is pretty serious. So it's coming from computer science, where you consider multi-thread problems, or just any collection of processes which can run concurrently, but sometimes they can see some conflicts. You can think about it, so a family of processes, you just find a family of processes, and so the time, you have a physical time x, t is, actual unit Unix time. This xi is the position of the process in its execution state, right? So that you're executing this process again. You don't know how often you're executing, and so you don't sort of go into branching, forking, whatnot. Just linear execution of some process, and from over tracking. And but there are conflicts. So here, let's look what the conflict can look like. A linear, you don't backtrack. Right.
All you need is no backtrack.
You don't backtrack. Yeah, you don't have control point which you can go backwards and sort of resume. In some models, they do it, but that's what we
understand what you mean. I just understand the use of the linear.
Oh yeah, linear, yeah. No branching, because it's algorithm. People might ask, okay, so what if statement gives you this, just assume you know how to execute, right? However, they are complex. Right? Anyway, so this is type of complex. So you have the three processes in their linear time. And this is the potential interval where something, you know, so this is a conflict. I denote the conflict by this segment. This is the conflict which involves two processes. It means that during this period, when the first process is within this interval, and the second process is within this interval, they cannot be at the same interval simultaneously. So, for example, you're addressing the same record in the database.
Sorry, I couldn't hear you. Could you please repeat that?
Yeah.
When they have those two intervals, what happens?
When the processes, the process number one and process number two, they cannot be within those two intervals simultaneously.
Simultaneously.
Yeah. They have to be in those intervals to go to progress, but you know, they cannot quite, because maybe they just, this guy is trying to address some region of port, right? Some your
resource.
Yeah.
Some resource port. I mean, like, you know, useful to think about as database record. You know, you try to change some database record, another guy is also, so you want to block them. So this is the standard, you know, semaphore techniques invented by Dijkstra in the 70s and, you know, like big computer science literature around it. I mean, like people, you know about, thought about it. So this is sort of standard, you know, one-to-one algorithms problem. Some conflicts involve more than two processes, right? For example, there is a resource which, you know, can, you know, digest two processes but not three. So this is very general formulation. So this is triple conflict. So these three processes cannot occupy this, you know, out of these three processes, it was two can be in those three intervals simultaneously, not all three of them. Right? So this is not equivalent to having three concurrent conflicts. Right? This is conflict of three guys. So this is the type of conflicts people consider in computer science. And you know, but you know, it's much easier to draw this picture in this way, right? So if you sort of plot how the first guy will be executed, plot how the second guy will be executed. And the condition that you're not occupying those two, not entering those two levels simultaneously, means that the execution path is avoiding this particular block, this particular square. So we want to understand, so we have, this is just one, you know, one conflict, one obstacle. You can have many obstacles. The condition that you are not backtracking means that your curve is increasing coherently. There is this cone, there is this portant which points to the, you know, positive, not negative directions, and your curve should go along this cone. You know, and you're asking how many potential ways are there to go from beginning to end? So you have an execution, and here obviously there are two ways, you know, this way and that way, and oh boy, the results might be very different. So imagine that one way is you trying to report the stolen credit card, and another process is the guy trying to withdraw money from your car. Right? So, you know, in one case, you win, in the other case, he does. So that's important, right? To understand the space of the project is important. Another, you know, like, you can think about it as, software verification. Right? So this is the conditions which, you know, like, you know, if you have different execution paths, you want to make sure that all execution paths lead to some, you know, safe outcomes. So you want to count how many potential different executions and different outcomes can result. So clearly, if you slightly deform this way, it means that, you know, you're just changing a little bit order, you know, like performances. Nothing bad can happen if you slightly change, kind of deform this way, as long as you're just in the class of the obstacle avoiding and monotonically increasing path. However,
in the example that you gave, you have one obstacle avoidance,
right.
Another one,
right.
But they're not at the same point. So
that's right. Yeah.
When you use this for safety, it means that the path themselves can be wrong. So the one in the navigate where the one path, now was the order.
Right, you know, this is,
the
intermediates are different paths which right. Give the same results. So in the path we don't begin. The idea is to, we have absolute enormous amount of number of different execution paths, but what counts is the relatively few discrete type of classes where you, you know, where they go around those obstacles in different ways. So you want to reduce the number, it's not a function, you want to go away from this functional space of all possible curves, which increase and avoid this bed. The discrete, you know, you'll see some, you know, something which just doesn't pay attention to, you know, this minutiae, but pays attention to this problem. This is computer science iteration. So now, of course, the other motivation that when I started with is in robotic and motion planning. So you have a robot, and in motion planning, exploration of trajectories is a big, big theme in robotic communities because, you know, robots, you have to plan everything for them, they don't know anything. So I mean, think about it again, just, you know, you have a state space, you have some limited velocity, you have some, you know, collection of obstacles. You can think about the, you know, trees you have to avoid, and, or the bullets you want to avoid, explosions in the space you want to avoid. So, and you want to plan the position of the robot. So, or alternatively, so there's other ways you can think about this robotic hand, which you, you know, or your hand, when you try to reach between those, you know, ports in your cabinet, port cabinet, and try to reach exactly, you know, the skillet up there, how, you know, how many ways you go there. This is also motion planning problem, not very far away from what we can see. So, yeah, so when understand this structure, this space, again, not up to minutia, but, you know, number of kind of, to understand the structure, different structure, different ways. Okay?
So, question, it's in this context, it's clear that we have some natural notions of continuous deformation, so
yeah,
paths from the physical context. But in the other setting of concurrency,
yeah,
what sorts of topologies are necessary to be considered in order to think about the equivalence problem for the paths?
So here, if you just deform the set a little bit, that means that what happens is, you know, here you perform some arithmetic computation, or like, you know, do something. This process first and that process first. But as long it's, you know, you change the order of those, you know, computation, it doesn't matter.
So if the order, the notion of homotopy of one of those paths to another red one below the first one that you've drawn,
right,
is something so natural if you're talking about robotics. So I want to know if there is some natural notion of homotopy
This is still a little bit of a discrete world. So you can imagine just, you know, pixelated, you know, this pixelated picture of this thing. And just shifting this guy, you know, from this way to that way means that there's some small iterations, which was one first in one process and then in the second in physical time, and you just swap them. So this is the this commodity there, which again, it's immaterial. So the notion of commodity in this concurrency, this computer science context, is also very natural, means you don't pay attention in what order the operations are executed in these different threads, as long as they are outside of the comp itself. Again, this model, this concurrency, sort of, it's called geometric or topological approach to concurrency problem, and it's like the French school started in the late 90s, you know, several, you know, a dozen of PhDs, you know, like a hundred of papers, but it's, you know, it's a developed problem. I think the first guy who looked at this from geometric level was one Pratt from, Stanford. Yeah, I think he was to sort of introduce the geometric picture, and then, you know, like, it took a little bit of life on its own. Okay, so let's go back to our, you know, nice high school example, right? So this is the picture, just five obstacles. So who can count the number of ways to go around there? I'll give you a minute. It's not easy, right? You sort of okay. So in this two-dimensional situation, right? So you can go this way, number one, you can go number two, you can go this way, number three, okay, so you can go maybe number four, number five, number three. this hill.
You go straight up.
Okay. Yeah, I can go straight up, which is a few minutes ago. Yeah, yeah. So anyway, so
about that.
Well, chaotic guesses. Correct. Right? However, there is a way to kind of compute it very easily, right? So this is a surprisingly easy answer. Total number of different, in this particular situation, in two-dimensional, you know, everything is on the plane. Right? You have this, you have, you know, your cone is just, your cone just a positive coordinate, so you can have to increase the both coordinates, so this is my cone. Right? So your tension vector should be in this cone. So number of ways to go around those obstacles from this corner to that corner is equal to the number of chains of obstacles. And chain of obstacles is just what it sounds. It's just the collection of obstacles such that each next will be beating the previous one by the cone. Right? So how many chains are there?
Your partial order by the height?
By the cone.
By the cone.
Yeah. So this point beats this one. This one beats this one. Yeah. So how many chains are there? There are several chains of length 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. So there are 4 chains of length 2. There are 5 chains of length 1. Right? Just the points themselves. And 1 empty chain. 10. The answer is 10. Okay? So another case of the non-situation, you have just three obstacles sitting, 1, 2, 3. Right? So the number of ways to run, so if they form, if the obstacles form what is called an anti-chain, right? So then there's just the number of various ways around them is equal to the number of obstacles plus 1. Right? There are just 3 obstacles, there are 4 ways around them. It's exactly it. So this is nice, already some nice result, right? And the proof is extraordinarily easy. So here's the proof. Take any path. And imagine you just, there is gravity pulling in this direction, but the path should satisfy your cone constraints. So you let it fall down, so imagine there is a gravity pointing in this direction. So you let it fall down so in such a way that it still sits within the cone. Then it will be hanging on some of these obstacles. These obstacles on which it will be hanging will form a chain. And vice versa. If you have a chain, you can always find, you know, a curve which hangs exactly on them. Actually, it proves a little bit more. So this space, it tells you that, you know, consider all paths which will be hanging on exactly those two guys. And the space, it's big, it's infinite dimensional space, right? It's functional space. But you know, we can prove that its space is contractible. It has topology of, in some sense, topology of a point. It can contract everything smoothly, deform it to a point. It doesn't have anything complicated behind it. And this is the type of results we want to address. And this is not easy because this is a two-dimensional situation and the obstacles are point-like. So this is the easier problem. So imagine what would happen if you look at the something higher dimension. In higher dimension, of course, the situation might be a bit. Let me just emphasize the result. So the result here is that the space of all directed paths avoiding those obstacles has the number of components of this space. The components of this space are in one-to-one correspondence with increasing chains of obstacles, and each of the component is this big block, but it's just that a block, it doesn't have internal life. It's contractible to a point. Let's consider the general problem. So our general problem will be you have this ingredient space, this is our state space. We have this convex open cone to tell us which directions you're taking. You'll have some collection of obstacles. Okay, should be nearby. Good. Given this data, we want to understand the space of directed path avoiding those obstacles. By understanding the space, this means we don't want to say, okay, it's, you know, smoothness, but not, you want to understand the topology of this equation. You want to understand what each component looks if we abstract all the know, genetic details, and look at all these sort of discrete, whatever discrete residues there. So in this talk and in general, the approach I will be talking about deals mostly with the time-like obstacles. By time-like obstacles, I mean that it looks, you cannot dance with it, you cannot follow the obstacle. You can imagine the obstacle is this cool, you can think about it as the defining the space-time structure. So you can sort of, the time is progressing upwards, this is limits your velocity. And it means that the obstacles, they sort of appear in time and disappear, they go away. It's like the tree. If you go downhill, you see the tree, you don't dance around the tree. So this condition being time-like, in some sense means that you cannot sort of do elaborate waltz with your obstacle. You see it once and then forget about it. It goes away. Because otherwise, if you can do a dance, then the topology of the space of paths around this obstacle, which avoid the obstacle, becomes infinite dimensional. You cannot, in all examples we will be looking at, the topology will collapse to something finite dimensional. For example, to a point, right? In the example before, everything was just some collection of points, to a discrete set, which says it has no topology. If you allow to dance around an obstacle, then your topology will be intrinsically infinite dimensional. Nothing wrong about it, but it's a different problem, a different beast. Require a different collection of them. Okay. This is the big geometric constraint. But this geometric constraint definitely is satisfied in concurrency problem. It is more or less satisfied in all the motion planning problems. Okay. So once again, the message is we want to study the topology of the space. Look at the space of all obstacle avoided, directed path, and we look at the topology. Topology is, we are trying to abstract away all the sort of continuous features and try to preserve only whichever discrete patterns are there. And the characteristic is especially interested in the homology groups. Homology groups just measure how many holes are there in your space. For example, if the space has two components, it's a big hole, right? You go from one component to another component, you have to jump over a big hole. There might be holes which don't disconnect the space. You can imagine this is the typical space with non-trivial topology, right? Just homologies allow you to measure how many holes in your space, how many holes your space has. If there is some tunnel going from here to there, this is a one-dimensional hole because you can go around it. And when you go around it, you cannot, contract it, you cannot patch it. So, to try to understand this invariant, it's called homology groups, which again, essentially, sounds, more abstract than it should be, so this is essentially sounds the science of counting the holes in the space. So, a sphere has one hole inside it. Right, two-dimensional sphere has one hole, you can think about, okay, so this is something which two-dimensional homological capture does. If you have a loop which you cannot patch, in this space, then it's one-dimensional homology captures. Zero-dimensional homologists, I mentioned, they tell you something about the dimension, the number of connected components in the space. Okay. So that's why we're asking about it. And again, I'll do a little bit of digression here. So people quite often ask, okay, so number of connected components can understand why it's important, right? So this is two different, like in this example, like in this different execution path, different behaviors. Problem, yes, please.
Superficially, in homology context, you care about the loops and very time.
Right.
But in your discussion of obstacles as being time-like, it seems to me that you're interested in paths that do not have any loop aspects to them, right?
Right, right. But we are not talking about the
speed of
paths. It's not about, right, it's not about loops represented by the paths themselves, it's the loops in the space of paths.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So connecting a point is in the space of paths.
Yeah.
It's a little bit sort of next
level. Yeah.
So, So people, you know, quite often people ask why these homology groups, why they, you know, why people, why they're important. They actually are very important for the control theories. But in motion planning, they're probably even more important, you know, like higher homology groups. For motion planning, they're even more important than the, which has the number of connections and components for the following reason. So imagine you want to optimize, and typically that's what happens. You have some, you know, configuration space, say, you know, collection of trajectories will go from A to B, and you want to optimize in this space, or you want to create some feedback control, you want to do something with that, right? It turns out that the topology of the space, so the space might be connected, so you can optimize, you can go from any point to anywhere. However, if you run any gradient algorithm, this gradient algorithm, you'll have some stationary points. So if you have some non-trivial homologies, you have a sphere, imagine you have a function of the sphere. Yes, the sphere is a compact. It definitely has a minimum point. However, it will also have some, you know, some maximum point. It means that any gradient algorithm will be hovering a long time around this point. So all non-trivial homology groups, they force the functions to try to minimize. We have some auxiliary minima. If you do feedback control, any feedback control, you'll be forced to have some places where you have to either spend a lot of time trying to run the gradient algorithm, you build some stationary point where you do just stalling, right? Or you do some, you know, some kind of discontinuous control. And in the case of discontinuous control, you'll be forced to choose direction. You go on the right side or the left side, so you have to choose which kind of controls you're using. Right? So anyway, so this. These topological characteristics, they are not exotic exotic toys we just invented to play with. They are very material obstacles, and they, you know, especially now when we're getting more and more complicated systems, multi-agent systems, where, you know, you have a lot of interactions, these conflicts do inflict very non-trivial of this directed space, directed path spaces. They do inflict a lot of non-trivial topology on you and cause your algorithms to be different. Okay, so just going back to your question, so if you have an obstacle, so each obstacle generates some kind of local homology class. Homology class of dimension, so co-dimension of an obstacle, you know, again, I will be looking over the obstacles which look like some linear, affine linear subspace, some points. Again, it's not a very big simplification, but nonetheless. So we'll have something like a line in the space which we want to avoid. We have a point in the space we want to avoid. Right? If you're James Bond and, you know, you're going down the slope, then bullet, it will be something co-dimension two, some like line in your space. So you can go around this bullet this way or that, or this or a tree, right? You go around the tree and go this way or that way. So it means that you have something of codimension. Two codimension is the number of equations you need to define this obstacle. Right? This obstacle in three-dimensional space is given by two equations, right? It's one-dimensional thing in three-dimensional space, two equations. So codimension is equal to two, and it's defined as two minus two zero-dimension class. Two different components, right? So one component is the path going above, another component is the path going below. If it's codimension three, it does not separate the space. You can, you know, but it defines something one-dimensional. So it defines some one-dimensional, non-patchable loop in the space of all paths. So this is the directed path, and you can easily see there is sort of a whole circle of those paths avoiding this guy. And this circle is not patchable. In the space of paths, you cannot say, okay, we just straighten everything. This is one-dimensional family, which you cannot contract or patch with something. But this is essential. This is the type of the local obstacles they generate. And the dimension of those local obstacles, the dimension of these homology classes they produce, is equal to L minus 2, where L is the co-dimension of the obstacle. So this is important to remember. So we call these local classes. So you have something like that, it generates a local class. Okay, so here's the approach. So again, this is the big work, and this, you know, I want to give just well-defined statement. So this well-defined statement deals with you know, this equation. So if we have again, if we have a sequence of obstacles, we call it a chain of obstacles. Well, we have to define what the chain of obstacles is, because you know, before the obstacles were point-like, right? It was just the points, it was easy to understand what the point is, just you know, hop from one point to another, increasing along the column. If your obstacle is something extended, you want to say what it means to have a chain. I say that we have a chain if there is some collection of weaknesses. We can find point, one point in the first obstacle, second point in the second, so that the points will be ordered. It is not the ordering of the obstacles themselves, as we will see, because it might happen that, you know, for one point, one pair of points, one obstacle dominates, for the other pair of points, the other obstacle dominates, right? Now it prevents us from that. Again, if obstacles are point-like, this is the same, but in general, so let's say the chain of obstacles is a collection of this collection of, you know, that there is a chain of obstacles, that there is a collection of points sitting on those obstacles, and the points are ordered. And codimension of the chain of obstacles, we know what codimension of one obstacle is, codimension of the chain is the sum of codimensions. This is the main theorem which I want to talk about today, which I'm talking about today. And this is the nasty assumption, but you know, it does simplify the proof. So we can go away from that, but you know, from just to formulate it will become, you know, a page long. So it's, I don't want to do it now. So, yeah, so so if the obstacles don't intersect, so you have these guys, you know, sitting in the space, just they don't cross each other. Then the, you know, homology group don't have notation. This is sort of some technical thing, means that, you know, there is no some loop that you cannot patch a loop, but you know, sometimes you patch, you know, go the loop twice and you can patch it, right? It's, you know, those of you who study physics know this, you know, spinners, spinners. That's what underlying this. So it happens in physical world, but it doesn't happen here. Which it means. So the ranks. So okay. So we have this homology groups. This is the this homology groups of rank of dimension k. They tell us the total number of the sort of k-dimensional holes. The zero-dimensional holes are the holes of the zero-dimensional holes are the holes of zero-dimensional holes are the holes of dimension just the homology of dimension zero, and you can form those groups. And essentially, you can think about it as the some vector spaces, and the dimensions of these vector spaces tell us how many holes of different types are there. So each hole of dimension k tells you, so the Peter rank, you know, like a Peter number is Peter number Peter 3 is equal to 5, means there are sort of 5 equivalent holes of dimension 3. It turns out that you can just count them by the obstacles, just take all the possible obstacles. And these local classes, they generate all these homologies. Let's go to an example. You know, like it's, the theorem sounds more abstract than it should be. So here's an example. So this is my column. Those are my two obstacles. They are crossed, but they don't intersect. So my three-dimensional space. And you can see there are five essential ways to go from, you know, from bottom to top. You can go way, way behind those both obstacles. Can you know go in front of the first, in front of the second obstacle, but behind the first. You can smartly go between those. You can go from, you know, behind the first and then in front of the, oh, just in front of both of them. So five possible ways. And there are five possible chains of these obstacles. There's an empty chain, there's a chain of one first obstacle, chain of the second obstacle, chain from 2 to 1, so this is a chain from 2 to 1, and chain from 1 to 2. So anyways, this is, and here everything is zero dimensional, so there's sort of local dimension, higher dimension classes.
So I have a question. In this instance, these obstacles are actually continuing infinitely long,
yeah.
So that's why the front one cannot be deformed into the back one.
No, no, it's deforming from the front one. Oh, the
green
one. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, everything is continuing. Yeah, just have to, you know, constrained by the screen.
Okay.
I would draw an infinite picture.
Yeah, but because of the infiniteness of the obstacles, that there is no way the one.
Yeah, you know, like.
They have state classes.
Right, and actually I'm starting, there's a starting point here and end point there. Yeah. I don't depict them here. Yeah. So essentially I'm looking from, typically I look for the path going from one point, starting point to the end point.
Okay.
Right. So you can think about this starting point here, if you can go from starting to the end point this way, or that way, you know, there's like five ways to go from starting to the end point. So kind of what, how they extend out there, you know, that's the advantage. But yeah, that's true. So there's no way it would be allowed sort of the infinite path and be allowed to go to swing it all the way. There's no way to go off to infinity and sort of sneak behind. Okay, so just, you know, I will spend some time talking a little bit about the, you know, the proof. Again, this kind of, it's very doable. Everything is rather geometric. Constructions are, you know, are nice, and, you know, even the some more abstract topological stuff is something which, you know, very useful to learn. You know, like so first of all, you know the problem, you started the problem which is infinite dimensional. The space of path is infinite dimensional space, right? Which is bad. It's very hard to work with something infinite dimensional. So always try to collapse something to finite dimension. So this is how you do it. You create some sequence of surfaces called them transversals, which contain all the obstacles, which, you know, like. And such that, you know, like they are deformed anti-chain. So within each of the green lines, within each transversal, there are no pair of points comparable with respect to the core. Which means that each path, if you have a directed path, it will intersect each transversal at most once. And by second condition, by the condition that the all the obstacles are sitting within the transversal, means that if you take this path, take this piece and straighten it between those two transversals, we are not going to hit the obstacle because we are changing it only outside of the transversal. No obstacles are sitting in the transversal. Right? So we can straighten. So, and this is finite dimensional situation. Now we are, you know, now what we can do is we can say, okay, this is our starting point. We fix a vector pointing where we're going first, then fix a vector pointing where we're going next. So there is, you know, the whole thing becomes just a collection of directions we're going between the transversal.
So it's like any waves?
Huh?
It's like a wave in the obstacle. And then this generates something like a waypoint and trajectory, right? Because like if I can take linear trajectory,
yeah.
I create waypoint that path where
yeah,
I
right, right, you can think about it. Right.
Yeah.
And you know those waypoints, again, like yeah, so you create this, you know, create attention vector, you know, the vector array will intersect the first transversal. Then you make another decision, and so on. So these decisions will parameterize the whole space, and you know this is turns out to be the nice parameterization. The second component of the proof is actually the one I like, you know, like to talk about more, because you know it sounds like a lot of some topological notions, but you know Alexander duality is something which is extraordinarily useful. So what it tells you is that essentially Alexander duality is what we use all the time. So imagine, you know, like there is problem which all, you know, all Russians know, which the problem relies on the following very simple statement. So imagine you have a square, right? And you painted all the square into blue and red. So those two corners are red, those two corners are blue. Then if you have a red path going from here to there, or a red or blue path going from here to there. This is exclusive duality. So it's clear you cannot have both, right? Because those two paths would be intersecting, and the point of intersection would be either red or blue, right? So it will be bad. However, this is the second part of the complementary part of the statement, that if you cannot go from here to there, means you should be able to go from there to here. This is the Alexander duality. This is the first sort of the one of the many statements which fall into this general formula for Alexander duality. So, of course, it resembles a lot the dualities in the, you know, the standard duality in the optimization theory, right? The Parker theorem or whatnot, and it should be thought as such. So this is the very strong, again, it seems to be trivial at this level, but, you know, it's a very strong statement which, you know, propagates to higher homology groups. Here we're just talking essentially about the commutativity. You know, yes. So, and, you know, something, so essentially what the Alexander duality tells you, if you have a subset of a sphere, and planes of the sphere, right? So this is part of the plane, you can think about part of the sphere. subset of the sphere, and we have the topology of one set. Topology one set, more or less, or homology, sorry, not topology, homology of one set, more or less completely tells you something about the homology of the complement. So in our context, means that if you want to study the set of paths which are avoiding obstacles, essentially what it tells us, that you have to switch and study the set of which go through the obstacles. Not avoiding the obstacles anymore, go through them.
Yeah.
Now you have to study this set of paths which go through at least one of the obstacles. And this is where the chains are coming, because this is the path which are going through the obstacles. The chains to the obstacles is essentially the path which are going through them. And from that, you know, it requires a little bit more of, a little bit of technical dilemmas, which again, is very useful and rather elementary, you know, like everybody's, you know, like urge to learn about it, but, you know, not probably now. So it's, it tells you if you have, you know, some space connected, consisting of several pieces, then, you know, you can disentangle it. So this is what situation looks in our, so this is, in this space, it, you know, quite, you can construct, you know, I didn't draw here, it's already an overwrought slide. So you can construct here two transversals, you know, like one transversal going somewhere here, one transversal going somewhere there. And so the whole thing will be sitting within four-dimensional sphere, which is hard to visualize, that's why I drew something like two-dimensional sphere. This is blue circle is the infinity point in my two-dimensional sphere, right? So imagine this blue circle. And so anything coming from the first obstacle is this arc, from the second obstacle is the second arc. So this one is the all the path, all the obstacles which go for both of them in one order. This is all the obstacles going for the other order. This captures the pattern of intersections of the game. So this is the set of all the path hitting the first obstacle. This is all the path hitting the second obstacle. There are two collections of path hitting both of them in different orders. So. And indeed, if you look at the complement, there are exactly five components. This is a very realistic picture. You just have to multiply it by something two-dimensional, right? Because everything should be four-dimensional sphere and just present it as two-dimensional. You multiply everything by a two-dimensional disk, you will get exact topology of the space of directed path here. So this is the sort of the gist of the proof, and again, there are some. Of course, there's a lot of technical dilemma to rely on, but we're not going to do that right now. Okay? But yeah, so one of the sort of probably useful for the, again, the software verification folks, it gives you the, you know, some algorithm which tells you, you know, if you have some collection of obstacles, you might be not interested to, you know, maybe come taking all the classes, but you know, it's good to know how many various execution paths are there, right? You know it between, you know, number of chains, you can sort of argue that it's bounded by this or that, but you know, how many of those are. Then there is an algorithm, again, sort of algorithm, let me just, this is the picture.
Yeah.
So this is how you propagate. So here it is just, you know, like essentially you start here and ask, okay, how many ways to go from here to there? There's one way. This number one is going to change somewhere. So how it changes? If you pass around this guy, it will be just doubling, because you can go around obstacle below and above. And if you go around this crossing, so you want to propagate, so from here one, you create this two. Here, create this two. So we can create this three. The rule is that if you have something like this, the crossing of several hypersurfaces, you propagate them in harmonic ways. So the function should be harmonic, means the sum of those two guys should be equal to the sum of those two guys. So this is one, this is two, this is two, this should be equal to three. Right? So three, three, two, four. Three, double six. Three, four, six, seven, and so on. And in the end, we end with this five, this ten, which you already know. So again, this is algorithm, and this is you know, algorithm which is polynomial. It is not the best algorithm. Probably some smart people would easily produce some, you know, much better algorithm. But you know, like it's already polynomial in the number of obstacles and the number of dimensions. So it's not a bad situation. So I think
and the actual cone doesn't matter to this calculation. In other words, if I have.
Oh, yeah, it does. You know, the actual, this, you know, this shapes, is the boundary. You take the obstacle.
You can make the cone narrower.
Yeah, you take, take the Minkowski sum of obstacle in the cone, which is easily computable, and, you know, this gives you the, this shape is the Minkowski sum of the obstacle in the cone. Okay, so.
So what if you don't know the obstacle, but I add obstacle, can I do this carefully? In the number of options, I think so. But I have one calculation.
Always forgetting, so to give the references, because you know I don't like these references. So the people who are writing about spaces are very bad, and typically they're boring direction with absolute nonsense. So this kind of this 100 papers which dedicated concurrency problem, most of the results will be that some very complicated space, not nice space, not space very bad, some very complicated space is equivalent to another category or some another very complicated space. Not just the, why it's interesting, what they say is definitely they cannot compute anything.
Right.
This is a nice outcome is that finally we can compute something, and we can compute in a situation far more general than just the concurrency problem. Because concurrency problem is very restrictive because all the obstacles are just going along the coordinate axis, essentially, and all your cones are just the orthogs. Here it is much more general situation, which is much more adaptive to control theoretic applications. And topology is manageable. Everything is computable. There's some nice collection of technical results you can rely on. So this sort of relation to some couple of mental theories getting worth exploring. But what's most exciting to now is that the there's some very natural generalizations. So what happens if you just consider the, not just the directed path where you can just turn and feel, which is physical, right? What happens if you have differential constraints? You have some non-holonomic mechanics, right? So you cannot turn your radius of turn is bounded from below by something, right? From above by something. So I encourage you to radius of blue is bounded, the radius bounded from below curvature from above. Something is bounded from something. This one is right. Anyway, so yeah, so this is extraordinarily interesting to see how this, and again, the same, the Alexander duality is sort of the kind of one of these magic bullets, in lieu of studying the spaces for quite avoiding, which is, like flat space, a lot of paths there. You have to look at the space, at the paths which are hitting those obstacles. And if you understand the topology of those, then you're more than done.
Okay, thank you.